In this video tutorial, I am going to discuss about DNA replication. DNA replication. Now we know that this DNA is genetic material. So this genetic material is required for the existence of the species. Without this genetic material, species cannot be remain in existence. Okay. So when cell undergoes cell division, suppose this is the parent cell. This is the parent cell. When this cell undergoes cell division, it forms two daughter cells. This is one daughter cell and this is second daughter cell with its nucleus or with its genetic material. These are the daughter cells. So when these daughter cells are generated after cell division, it contains the identical genetic material which parent has. So that means this genetic material, which in our case it is DNA, it gets duplicated in the high fidelity manner. So this process in which DNA copies itself, DNA is copying itself, this process, it is known as replication. It is known as replication. Now we know that DNA is a double helical structure. So suppose this is the DNA with this 5' to 3', and the second chain runs in the anti-parallel fashion. So it's a 3' to 5' end. So at the end of DNA replication, we get identical two DNA molecules, right, which are identical to this parent DNA. This is the parent DNA. So this is the one daughter DNA molecule, which is in all sense identical to this parent DNA, and the second DNA molecule, which is also identical to its parent DNA. Suppose this is the 5' to 3', and this is 3' to 5'. Similarly, in this case also 5' to 3' and 3' to 5' end. Now, in this case, what happens is that one strand, this 5' to 3' strand, it is derived from this parent strand, whereas other strand, this 3' to 5', it is the newly synthesized chain. Whereas in other case, this 3' to 5' is derived from this parent, and this 5' to 3', this chain is newly synthesized. This yellow highlighted chain is newly synthesized. So as DNA of the parent is not fully conserved into the DNA of the daughter cells, so we call this replication process, this DNA replication process, as a semi-conservative DNA replication. Suppose it is happening like this. This daughter cells DNA is like this. This is, and the second daughter cell DNA is like this. In one daughter, the DNA is fully from the parent, whereas in other daughter, both strands are newly synthesized. So I am highlighting it with the yellow color. Suppose both the chains are newly synthesized. Then such process, if this process is happening, we could have called it as a conservative DNA replication. Or the third option is, if this is the DNA, two daughter DNA molecule, this is the second DNA daughter molecule, and DNA replication is this much part is from the parent, this much part is newly synthesized, this much part is from the parent, this much part is from the newly synthesized, this much part is from the parent, remaining part, this much part. So it's like a fragmented in nature. Fragmented in nature means some part in single DNA molecule, some part is from the parent and some part is from the newly synthesized. If this is happening, if such thing is happening where each single strand of DNA is derived from the multiple origin, then we could have called it as a non-conservative DNA replication. But remember, in our case, we have only semi-conservative DNA replication, and this conservative and non-conservative DNA replication never takes place. Okay, so this is the fact. So our DNA replication is semi-conservative in nature. One more thing that I want to tell you is that how many times DNA replication occurs. See, it undergoes, DNA is replicated whenever there is a requirement of cell division. So DNA replication occurs only single time per cell cycle. It never occurs multiple times during a cell cycle. During cell cycles, S phase of cell cycle, S phase of the cell cycle, this DNA replication occurs. The second important thing, this is the first important thing, okay? Never misunderstand that DNA replication occurs multiple times. No, this DNA replication occurs only when the cell wants to undergo cell division, and that too during S phase only. The second thing is that DNA replication is never partial. DNA replication is never partial. What do you mean by this sentence? That means once cell starts the DNA replication, it never stops in between until and unless the full genome of that particular cell is replicated. Then only it stops. Okay. So what does it mean? In other words, you can say when DNA replication initiates, it only terminates when full genome of cell is replicated. DNA replication never occurs like only that 10% part of the full genome is replicated. No, DNA replication is a full process. Once it starts, it ends only when full genome is replicated. Okay, so initiation of the DNA replication is the committed step. Now, what do you mean by committed step? Committed step means once that process is started and that particular step has occurred, it then never stops until and unless that process is complete. So in our case, our DNA genome is replicated. Okay, so once DNA commits, it never listens to itself also. Now, in this video or in the next video, whatever DNA replication I'm going to explain, it is of the E. coli. We are going to study DNA replication in the prokaryotes. We have multiple prokaryotes organism, but we will understand it by the E. coli as an example. And in the future video, we will also discuss about the eukaryotic DNA replication. Now, in the prokaryotes, as an example of E. coli, this DNA replication is well understood. But in eukaryotes or higher organisms, DNA replication is not well understood. Okay, so we'll try to fully understand the DNA replication of E. coli, and we will see the major aspects of the eukaryotic DNA replication. Now, the DNA replication enzymes, they do not recognize this double-stranded DNA. Okay, this enzyme interacts with only single-stranded DNA molecules. So the basic requirement will be the first, this double-stranded DNA molecule needs to melt or needs to denature. And we know the meaning of denaturation of the DNA. That means the separation conversion of double-stranded DNA to the single-stranded DNA molecule. So as we are taking example of prokaryotes as an example of E. coli, we know that in E. coli, there is a circular genetic material. DNA is in the circle. So let's first draw the circular genetic material. So this is the circular genetic material. Now, these are all hydrogen bonded, right? These are the two strands which are in the circulatory fashion, which are hydrogen bonded to its complementary strand. So what happens? This DNA needs to undergo denaturation at certain local portion. Okay, so there are certain AT-rich region. So suppose let's call this as an AT-rich region, which is very specific. It is not just any random site. It is AT-rich region. Now, what is this AT-rich region? Why this? Because we know that adenine binds with the two hydrogen bonds with the thymine, whereas G binds with three hydrogen bonds with the C. So of course, this AT bond is a weaker. So this AT-rich region is the starting point. It is the starting point for the DNA replication, right? So this is the origin of replication. Why origin of replication? Because it is AT-rich region, and so it has weaker hydrogen bonds. So this particular region of the DNA is very easy to denature. Okay. So what will happen once this part of the DNA becomes denatured? What will happen? It undergoes denaturation and such bubble will form. Okay, why? Now these both strands are not hydrogen bonded, and then here the DNA replication starts. Okay, both in the opposite direction. Let me show it by some other color. This newly strand I am showing by the green color, and this will start expanding. This process, this location, this particular location is known as DNA fork. okay, DNA fork, and this is the site of active replication. We will see about this replication fork in full detail later on, but right now just remember this part is the where active DNA replication is going on. Okay, so there are two replication forks. So now this DNA, this replication bubble, this full part is the replication bubble, and this replication bubble will start expanding. So what will happen? Slowly neighboring portion also undergoes this denaturation, and now the replication bubble is larger. It is like this, and so new DNA is now synthesizing like this in the opposite direction. So it will slowly start expanding. At the end of this process, what we will get is the two DNA molecules, and one chain is from the parent itself and second chain is the newly synthesized, right? So this is happening at the end of replication, and you can once again you can see over here the semi-conservative nature of the DNA replication. In case of eukaryotes where there are a linear genetic material, okay, in case of prokaryotes we have circular genetic material, okay, in case of eukaryotes or higher organism there is also a similar fashion that certain ATE rich regions are there, but in case of eukaryotes these ATE rich regions are multiple inside. So what will happen? It will have multiple replication bubbles. So let me show that multiple replication bubbles. So here one replication bubble, here second replication bubble. So it has multiple replication bubble. So what will happen? DNA replication will start at each of these replication bubble. Here also there is one replication bubble, and DNA replication is occurring in this replication bubble. So here we have multiple origin of replication site, whereas in case of prokaryote only one origin of replication, or you can say replication bubble, whereas in eukaryotes there are multiple origin of replication. Okay, so why in eukaryotes there are multiple origin of replication? What is the advantage? See, in eukaryotes or higher organism there is very huge genetic material, whereas in case of prokaryotes there is very minute amount of genetic material. Okay, so this large genome needs a multiple sites working together for the rapidly replicating this genetic material, right? So this multiple origin of replication provides a speed. With the higher speed, in a less time, this entire genome can get replicated. Whereas in case of prokaryotes, only single origin of replication is enough for the replication of entire genome, because it is short genome. Whereas in eukaryotes, there is a long genome. Okay, so these all the sites where this DNA replication starts, this small site, in this case initially this much small site was there, these are all known as, generic name is given, it is ORI. ORI means origin of replication. So ORI, if you want to enumerate the characteristic of ORI, it is the ATE rich region. It is not just any random location, okay, it's a one very well specified ATE rich region. In prokaryotes only one ORI site is there, whereas in eukaryotes there are multiple ORI sites are seen. Now let's say, for example, we had taken example of E. coli, right? In E. coli, this ORI site, what is this ORI site? ORI site, remember, it is the location on the DNA, okay, it is not any protein or carbohydrate or any other molecule. This ORI is the part of DNA, or you can say part of genome, okay. In E. coli, this ORI site, it is known as ORI C, with capital C. In case of bacteriophage lambda, which is a virus, bacteriophage lambda, this ORI site, this origin of replication, this site, it is known as ORI lambda. In the yeast cells, which is of the eukaryote, where this ORI site is there, it is known as ARS, and the full form of ARS is autonomous replicating sequences. And remember, yeast cell, these are the eukaryotes, so there are multiples of ARS are there, multiple of origin of replications are there, and they all collectively known as autonomously replicating sequences. This autonomously replicating sequences, it has inside it one very highly specifying region that is known as ORI, and the full form of ORI is origin replicating element. Origin replicating element. And this ARS are also, its other name is replicators. So now let's discuss further by taking example of our E. coli. Now in the E. coli, we know, we had very well discussed about the origin of replication or the oocyte. Suppose this is the oocyte of the E. coli genetic material. We know that this is very much rich in A and T base pair. So T binds with A like this. So this is the oocyte. This is the example of oocyte in the E. coli. It is the AT-rich region. So what happens? This site does not undergo denaturation by itself. This strand does not separate by itself. Certain proteins are required. These are known as ori binding proteins. Okay, ori binding protein, and these are the multimer units. So suppose these four ori binding proteins are attached with this site. In case of E. coli, these are the DNA A proteins. Right. So we had seen that in E. coli, the oocyte is known as ORI C, which binds with DNA A protein. So remember, ORI C is the part of DNA. Okay, it is the part of DNA, whereas this is the protein which binds with the oocyte. We had also taken example of bacteriophage lambda, where the oocyte is known as ORI lambda. This ORI lambda binds with O proteins. So their specific proteins are there, but as just we are taking example of E. coli, I am continuing this E. coli example with this. So in case of E. coli, these proteins are the DNA protein, and this DNA protein binds with this oocyte. Okay, we had also taken example of yeast cells, which is the eukaryotic in nature. Okay, and its oocytes are known as, it has multiple oocyte, and all the oocytes are known as ARS. Okay, this ARS binds with protein known as ORC. So the full form of ORC is the origin recognition complex. So for each oocyte, there are different protein, but they are structurally matching. For example, this ORC is very much similar in its amino acid sequence and the three dimensional structure. It is very much similar to this DNA A protein. But of course, species to species, these proteins are going to be a different, but it will be very much similar to the different species protein. Okay, so here in our case of example of E. coli, this oocyte binds with this DNA protein. So now this DNA A protein, what it will do with the help of ATP, it will start breaking the hydrogen bonds between this AT base pair. So what will happen? There will be a separation of these two strands, and so replication bubble will form. So let's show that. So here there is a local destabilizing of the double stranded DNA, and there will be a formation of replication bubble. So this replication bubble is formed. Why? Because now the hydrogen bonds of this AT base pairs are broken. So now this is the local single stranded DNA. Local single stranded DNA molecule is now achieved. So now this is the perfect place to start the DNA replication. Why? Because as I already told you earlier, that all the DNA replicating machinery or enzymes, they recognize single stranded DNA. The single stranded DNA will work as a template, okay, for the formation of new DNA strand. So now, as there is a formation of local stranded DNA and the neighboring DNA is double stranded DNA, so if you just focus on this part, so I can draw it like this. So this is the double stranded DNA molecule, and this is the single stranded, or you can call it as a replication bubble. Okay, here the hydrogen bonds are there, as it is a double stranded or undenatured DNA is there, native DNA is there, whereas this part where hydrogen bonds are broken, you can see over here that its shape is like a fork, and as it is for the replication, we call it as a replication fork. We'll study more about the replication fork in the next video. So if you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Thank you.